Good evening. My name is Courtney Davis, and I am president of the School of Public Health Alumni Association here at the University of North Carolina. And on behalf of the association, I would like to welcome you all, especially our alumni, to the Fred T. Foard Jr. Memorial Lecture. I am proud to hold both master's and doctoral degrees in epidemiology from the school. This training at the School of Public Health and my current work in the epidemiology department at GlaxoSmithKline have led me to a deep appreciation of the complex issues in global health. And like all of you here tonight, I am really looking forward to the lecture by Dr. Feachem. I'd also like to take a moment to mention that this week, April the 5th through the 11th, is National Public Health Week for 2004. This special recognition for our discipline provides an opportunity to highlight the array of threats to public health that are emerging and predominant in our society today, such as obesity, infectious diseases, and disparities in healthcare access and quality. It also affords the School of Public Health the opportunity to share the work that we are doing to develop solutions to all these problems and to many others. I hope you'll take the time over the next few days to visit our website and to learn more about the remarkable research, teaching, and practice that is being conducted here at the School of Public Health at the University of North Carolina. Now it's my pleasure to introduce the school's interim dean, Dr. Margaret Dardis. As many of you know, Dr. Dardis was named to succeed William Roper in February to guide the school until a new permanent dean is recruited. She is well suited to this role. She joined the School of Public Health in January of 2002 as Associate Dean of Administration and Adjunct Professor of Health Policy and Administration. She was later named Senior Associate Dean, and prior to joining the school, she spent 15 years with us at GlaxoSmithKline and legacy companies. So please join me in welcoming our new dean, Dr. Margaret Dardis.
Thank you, Courtney, and welcome. It's a real testament to your dedication to public health that you're with us tonight, the night before a long Easter weekend. And we're very impressed, and we welcome you to the 36th annual Fred T. Foard Jr. Memorial Lecture. This lecture series was named in memory of Dr. Fred Foard, a physician who dedicated over 50 years of his life to public health, most of which was devoted to the United States Public Health Service. And the highlights of his career are worth noting. During his tenure with the Public Health Service, Dr. Foard helped develop and strengthen the infrastructure of the health delivery systems. He was particularly influential in improvements in the health service for Native American populations. After retiring from the service in 1952, he joined us here in North Carolina, where until 1964, he was director of the Division for Epidemiology in the North Carolina Board of Health. Following his death in 1966, his wife, Elsie, established a trust to support this lectureship, thereby honoring his memory and the good works he did while introducing us every year to new ideas in public health through the lecture series. So on behalf of the UNC School of Public Health, we honor tonight Dr. Foard and his wife, Elsie, and all of you who for the very fine work that you're doing. Tonight's lecture underscores the school's commitment to global health. Our faculty and graduate students are exploring complex issues in developed and developing nations. For example, Dr. William Dow, professor in health policy and administration, is leading a project that analyzes China's changing health outcomes during that country's current economic transition. And as we continue to monitor developments in SARS in Asia, epidemiology professor Dr. Ralph Barrick is working with several teams to develop a SARS vaccine. Dr. Robin Ryder and Dr. Frida Behetz, both in epidemiology, are conducting research in the mother-to-child transmission of HIV in Russia, Angola, Madagascar, and the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Many of our researchers focus on the small southern African country of Malawi, one of the epicenters of the African HIV pandemic. Among these are Dr. Linda Adair and Dr. Stephen Meshnick of epidemiology, who's conducted significant research on HIV and its interrelationship with malaria. Dr. Peggy Bentley also works in Malawi. Specifically, her research focuses on mother-to-child transmission of HIV as it relates to nutritional practices. Dr. Bentley also pursues research on HIV in India, where the epidemic is growing rapidly. She leads our school-wide effort in global health and, in addition to being a professor in the Department of Nutrition, serves as Associate Dean for Global Health. So therefore, it's fitting that she would introduce tonight's speaker, Dr. Richard Feachem, Executive Director of the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria. So thank you all very much for being here tonight. I hope you enjoy the presentation. Dr. Bentley?
I'm short. I am honored to introduce Dr. Richard Feachem, the first executive director of the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria. As the Associate Dean for Global Health, one of my primary goals is to raise the activities and profile for global health in the school through the visits of distinguished speakers such as Dr. Feachem. The Office of Global Health has had a really active year in which we established the new Global Health Certificate Program for graduate students and instituted a monthly Global Health Seminar Series. We have a large, dynamic, enthusiastic student Global Health Committee whose energy is boundless, and I can barely keep up with them. They've just had a really lively discussion, an hour-long discussion with Dr. Feachem, and I wished we had been able to videotape it because it was really wonderful. One key event was our involvement with the Narratives of HIV series, co-sponsored by the Schools of Journalism and Mass Communications, Medicine, the Center for AIDS Research, and the School of Public Health. These events included film showings, talks by the film directors, discussions with people living with HIV, and a lecture given by a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist. Large numbers of students, faculty, staff, and community members participated in these events. We were therefore inspired to invite a renowned expert in this field to give the Fred T. Foard Jr. Memorial Lecture. Dr. Feachem, a British national, has 30 years of experience in global health, including the last 2 years as director of the Global Fund. He holds a PhD in environmental health from the University of New South Wales and a medical degree from the University of London. He has held several important positions, including Director of Health, Nutrition, and Development Population at the World Bank, Dean of the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, Director of the Institute of Global Health at the University of California, San Francisco, and Berkeley, and he's been a consultant expert on many policy boards with the World Health Organization. I have known Richard since 1985, when we were both involved in research on diarrheal diseases in Asia. I can tell you that he is a visionary, one who sees critical global health issues in all their breadth and complexity, before turning his attention to working with colleagues to understand and frame solutions. His research on diarrheal diseases in developing countries led him to first investigate its etiology and epidemiology. He soon became a moving force at the global level for influencing treatment and management programs and policy. As Dean of the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Health, he was a pivotal figure in defining how to structure public health education, and he understood the importance of building and strengthening institutions for training public health scientists and leaders. Dr. Feachem has worked all over the world, and I'm not going to tell you the 25 countries that are on my list here. He speaks several languages and is fluent in Tok-Pisin, the language of Papua New Guinea. He has co-authored or authored 14 books and over 200 papers and has received numerous awards and honors, and I'm going to embarrass him by telling you that that includes he's a commander of the Order of the British Empire for Services to International Health, awarded by Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. Dr. Feachem will speak today on fighting the great pandemic, leadership, technology, money, and research. It is my great honor to introduce to you Dr. Richard Feachem.
Well, thank you very much, Peggy, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure and a privilege to be here, and I thank the School of Public Health for the kind invitation. As I was saying to several people over the reception, although I've had connections with UNC and RTI over many years, this is actually my first visit, and it's a great, great pleasure to be here. Every year, as many of you will know, the World Bank publishes a World Development Report. And in 1993, for the first time ever, that World Development Report was devoted to the subject of health. And it was published under the title Investing in Health. And I had the privilege to chair the International Committee, which steered and guided that publication. And in that World Development Report of 1993, we made an extraordinary assertion, which was that human health, as measured by life expectancy at birth, had increased more in the past 40 years than in the previous 4,000 years. We couldn't exactly prove that assertion, although we believed it to be true, and we still believe it to be true. And it set a very positive and hopeful backdrop to that report on investing in health. 10 years later, we have, I think somewhat belatedly, come to realize that while in general the health of the world's population continues to increase, there are five elements which are worsening alarmingly. Two of these are chronic and non-infectious in nature, and I won't dwell on them. They are everything relating to the epidemic of tobacco abuse and everything relating to the pandemic of obesity. But the other three of the five alarmingly worsening problems are infectious, and they are, of course, AIDS, TB, and malaria. Let me say just a few words about each of these, and in some ways I hesitate to do so to this professional and experienced audience, but I do think we need to constantly remind ourselves quite how bad the situation is and how rapidly it is worsening. Let me start briefly with malaria. When I was dean of the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, the first Nobel Prize ever awarded to a Brit hung on the wall of my office. It happened to be a Nobel Prize for Medicine, and it was awarded in 1904 to Major Ronald Ross of the Indian Army Medical Service. Ross, as many of you will know, working in Hyderabad in the 1890s, discovered that the malaria parasite was transmitted by Anopheles mosquitoes. He returned to London, established the Ross Institute, and devoted the rest of his life, with considerable success, to controlling malaria, especially in Asia. Over 100 years since Ross's discovery, malaria worsens rapidly. We have a program since the late 1990s, called Rollback Malaria. But this is not occurring. Malaria is actually rolling out, not rolling back. It spreads upwards and becomes increasingly endemic at higher altitudes. It causes more frequent urban epidemics. It spreads outwards from its previous heartland to newly colonized areas. It reinvades areas which hitherto enjoyed malaria eradication, such as Florida, or more importantly, the countries of Central Asia. It took the Soviet Union 50 years to completely eradicate malaria within its borders. but it has taken only 5 years to reestablish endemic malaria in Turkmenistan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Georgia, and Armenia. Most tragically, malaria intensifies in its heartland, tropical Africa. It now causes a quarter of childhood deaths in many African countries, and the mortality rates are climbing fast. Turning briefly to tuberculosis, as you're well aware, tuberculosis worsens rapidly around the world on the coattails of HIV/AIDS. It is by far the most common cause of death of HIV-positive people in low-income countries, and the particularly difficult and expensive to treat form of tuberculosis, the multiple drug-resistant TB, breeds in Russian prisons and elsewhere and causes a new and alarming threat. It is also a disease which travels very easily. And so to HIV/AIDS. And in many ways, we have run out of words. We've run out of hyperbole to describe how bad the HIV/AIDS situation in the world today is. But let me have a shot at it. It is, without question, the greatest disaster in recorded human history. It is already worse than the Black Death in Europe and Asia Minor in the middle of the 14th century. And the word already is very important because it will get much worse before it gets better. And even if we did all the right things tomorrow, and there is no chance that we will do all the right things tomorrow, even if we did do all the right things tomorrow, HIV/AIDS would still get much worse before it peaked and began to decline. The epicenter of the epidemic today, as you're aware, is in the countries of Southern Africa, where, as we've heard, some of you conduct important work. 30 to 40% of young adults infected, and therefore having a death sentence placed on them in the absence of access to antiretroviral therapy. School teachers in Zambia being killed by HIV at exactly twice the rate that school teachers in Zambia are being trained. This means that the education system in Zambia is collapsing, not may collapse, but is collapsing. No education system, no future, no tomorrow. Three African heads of state have predicted that if the epidemic continues in their countries on its current course, that their countries will cease to exist as organized nation states. Further north, in the two most populous countries in Africa, Nigeria and Ethiopia, the epidemic is running a few years behind, but absolutely on the same trajectory. Prevalence rates rise rapidly, and there is nothing in place in those countries of a sufficient scale and of sufficient seriousness to prevent the rates rising to Southern African levels. Meanwhile, and inexorably, the epicenter moves to Asia, and the face of the pandemic becomes an Indian face. Official statistics would tell you that South Africa has the most HIV-positive people in the world, followed closely by India. But official statistics are clearly wrong. And India today already has, by far, the highest number of HIV-positive people in the world. India is on an African trajectory, but just running 15 years behind. And there is nothing going on in India today that comes close to the scale or the effectiveness which will prevent an unfolding catastrophe. To make matters worse, the epidemic in India, in my opinion, is likely to be greater and more severe in the Hindu population than in the Muslim population, thus further exaggerating the interfaith tensions in that country. And I haven't mentioned China, and I haven't mentioned Russia and Ukraine, which have the world's fastest growing HIV epidemic. This catastrophe, which we struggle to describe, has unfolded while we sat on our hands and did very little. I sometimes say that the state of the epidemic today is, to a first approximation, what it would have been if we'd had a major international conference in 1983 and decided deliberately to do nothing and to see what would happen. We have not, to the first approximation, made a material difference to the natural history of this virus in Homo sapiens. It is also unfolded while we denied and denied and denied again. It cannot happen to me, we said around the world loudly, and we continue to say it. I am culturally immune. I am an African man, not a gay man in San Francisco. I am an upper caste Hindu, not an African. This is someone else's problem, not mine. How wrong, how tragically wrong we have all been. So now we are all feeling alarmed, ashamed, and depressed, which are all appropriate reactions, I think, in the face particularly of the HIV/AIDS pandemic. But over the past year or two, there has been an extraordinary change, and the clouds have parted and a ray of sunshine is shining through. And we have hope and we have optimism of a kind that we haven't seen before in the unfolding pandemics. And the cause of this hope is the three preconditions necessary to turn the tide. Only a few years ago, we did not have those preconditions, and now we do. And they are leadership, practical and affordable technologies, and money. And let me comment very briefly on those three conditions. Leadership. You will be very aware of the story. It's wrapped up in the phrase breaking the silence. President Bush, his leadership, the $15 billion of new commitment from the United States, the launch of the President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, PEPFAR. President Chirac, a constant advocate for the global battle against HIV/AIDS, recently trebling France's contribution to the Global Fund. Tony Blair in London, preparing to devote the year 2005, a year in which he will be the president of the G8, and in the second part of the year, the president of the European Union as well, to the cause of development, particularly development in Africa, and particularly HIV/AIDS. The former Japanese Prime Minister, Prime Minister Mori, agreeing to chair a new non-governmental organization in Japan called Friends of the Global Fund. African leaders speaking out as never before, Chissano, Kagame, Obasanjo, Annan, and many others. The leaders of the great faiths of the world speaking out or beginning to speak out, engaging, becoming part of the solution rather than part of the problem. The Indian Prime Minister meeting with HIV-positive people and touching them. The Indian President calling for a greater role for the Indian biotechnology industry in discovery of an HIV vaccine. These are all symptoms that we read about every day in the newspapers of the emergence of strong leadership in the North and the South, and an unequivocal call to confront the pandemic seriously and on a large scale. Secondly, I mentioned technology. We have now what we have to some degree lacked hitherto, which is practical and affordable technology. The most striking example of that, as everyone knows, is antiretroviral therapy and antiretroviral drugs. Only 3 or 4 years ago, this therapy cost roughly $25,000 a year, and involve taking something between 20 and 30 pills per day. It now costs $140 per year, less than 50 cents a day, and involves taking two pills per day, pills such as these. Another example, equally important in the field of malaria, is the long-lasting pre-impregnated bed net. The bed net developed by Sumitomo Chemical in Japan, which when you buy it, has the insecticide already built into the fabric. And it lasts for 5 years, by which time you have to buy a new bed net anyway, because if you use a bed net every day, it gets torn and damaged in much less than 5 years. An important technical breakthrough, now out-licensed to net manufacturers in Tanzania, so that Africa can begin to make its own long-lasting bed nets. And the third condition that I mentioned is money. Lots and lots and lots of new money. And this is where the Global Fund enters the story. In 2002, in January 2002, the Global Fund was created for the sole purpose of raising and distributing large amounts of additional money to finance the counterattack against AIDS, TB, and malaria. The Global Fund is an independent private foundation based in Geneva. Today, it has assets of $5.4 billion, not nearly enough, but much better than the zero that we had only 2.5 years ago. Our current portfolio is 225 programs in 121 countries. And at 9 a.m. on Monday of this week, round four closed, and hundreds of new applications were received from all around the world, which, when the decisions about them are taken in June, will further expand that portfolio. 60% of the Global Fund's money goes to HIV/AIDS, 20% to TB, and 20% to malaria. 60% goes to Africa, and 40% goes to all other parts of the world. 50% is received by private, non-governmental organizations and faith-based organizations, and the other 50% is received and used by governments and government programs. And the fascinating thing is that we have no policies on any of the things I've just described. We have no policies on AIDS versus TB versus malaria. We have no policies on Africa versus the rest of the world. And we have no policies on public recipients versus private recipients. And the distribution of the investments that I've just described is an entirely demand-driven process. It is the outcome of the applications and the judgments made by our independent technical review panel on those applications. It is the outcome of that process. It is completely demand-driven. We have no influence on it at all, and that is the outturn. And that tells me that, I don't know whether it's Adam Smith's invisible hand, but somebody's invisible hand is at work here, because that demand-driven outcome is roughly what the experts gathered in this room would say is about right. And we had no hand in it. And that's a very important message, because it describes one of the great innovations of the Global Fund. We are radically passive. We have no hand in what proposals come to us, or from whom, or what the content of those proposals is. We have no policies on that subject. We give no guidance. Malawi sends to the Global Fund what Malawi wants to send to the Global Fund, and we express no opinion on that matter at all. There is no other aid agency in the world that operates in this way. There is no other aid financing mechanism that has adopted this radically country-owned, radically passive approach to development finance. The Global Fund is on a rising flight path to a cruising altitude, which we predict to be about $8 billion per year of steady state income and expenditure. And some people challenge me on that and say, that's too ambitious. $8 billion per year, that's four or five times more than the World Bank's total investments in health of all kinds. It's far more than all other development assistance for health added together. How can you hope to rise to a figure of 8 billion? It's too ambitious. It's too much. And my reply to that is, compared to what? Compared to the 60 or 70 or 80 billion being spent this year on Iraq and Afghanistan? I don't think so. I don't think it's too much compared to that. Compared to the $1.5 trillion, $1,500 billion, that the citizens of the United States will spend this year on their own health? No, I don't think it's too much compared to that. Or compared to the utter devastation that AIDS is causing around the world? I don't think it's too much in relation to that either. And let us remember that the longer we delay, the longer we postpone doing what is necessary, the more difficult and the more expensive it will become. Colin Powell says frequently that HIV/AIDS is a greater threat to the world today than terrorism. He's absolutely right. He is the only global leader of stature making those statements. I wish others would say that as well. The US government is by far the largest financial supporter of the Global Fund. In financial year 2004, the US Congress has appropriated $550 million to the Global Fund, and which is one-third of our need in the current year. And next year, we are seeking a figure of $1.2 billion from the United States, which will be a third of next year's need, which is $3.6 billion. This is very strong support. The Secretary for Health and Human Services, Tommy Thompson, chairs the board of the Global Fund and works tirelessly on behalf of the global efforts against HIV/AIDS. On Monday of this week, he was in Saudi Arabia solely for the purpose of raising increased funding for the Global Fund. And he traveled on to Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India. He returns this coming weekend to, again, promote the cause of AIDS, TB, and malaria control and to support the work that the Global Fund is financing. In my experience, his predecessors have never made this kind of commitment. The Global Fund cannot continue to grow, cannot fulfill its mission, cannot recognize the hopes and aspirations that people around the world have in us without the continued and growing support of the United States. And all of you can help ensure that this occurs. Please engage. Thank you very much.
Infrastructure for clinical care is so woefully inadequate, and with all the emphasis on antiretroviral,
Thanks for that question. And of course, that's a frontline question and a frontline challenge as we contemplate this massive scale-up of antiretroviral therapy in low-income countries with very weak healthcare infrastructure. And there's no doubt in my mind that this is the toughest challenge in medicine and public health that the world has ever taken on. We've never tried to do anything as difficult as this before. I would make three brief comments. One of them is that as I travel around Africa, I not only see the struggling infrastructure and the challenges, but I also see clinical settings in Africa where people are dying because this isn't in the cupboard. It's as simple as that, where there are the nurses and there are the doctors. And just for the want of the drugs, people are dying who need not die. And I've seen that in many countries. So my first comment would be an influx of antiretroviral drugs, well distributed to doctors and nurses who have had the necessary training quickly given to them, will save a lot of lives quickly, notwithstanding the weak infrastructure. And there are some countries, of course, South Africa notably, which has much stronger infrastructure and can do much more quickly. The second comment is, when we talk about healthcare infrastructure, it's important to ask whose infrastructure. There is the public healthcare infrastructure, which in Africa accounts for roughly 50% of all healthcare delivery. And then there's all the other healthcare infrastructure in the hands of the churches, in the hands of NGOs, in the hands of private providers of many kinds. There's all that infrastructure as well. And I think one of the important features of the Global Fund is to invest in everybody's infrastructure and everybody's programs, not just in the government programs. But then we come unavoidably to the reality of your comment, which is that we're not going to achieve our goals, either in HIV or in TB or in malaria, unless there is a massive strengthening of healthcare infrastructure. And one of the reasons that healthcare infrastructure in Africa is so weak is that we're spending $7, $8, $10, $12 per capita per year total on healthcare in those countries. And we know from a number of recent reports, including the Commission on Macroeconomics and Health, that roughly $35 to $40 per capita per year is an absolute minimum to finance a healthcare system worthy of the name of a healthcare system. So we need a massive increase in per capita annual expenditure on healthcare. And one of the things that's happening today as a result of PEPFAR and as a result of the Global Fund is that the sums of money available are rising very rapidly, doubling in some countries in a very short period of time. Now, spending that well will be a big challenge, but that is the fuel in the tank of the healthcare system. And with that, I think there's a prospect of rapid strengthening of the healthcare system in a way that will not only allow us to tackle AIDS, TB, and malaria, but many other things, because the clinics that we build, the laboratories we establish, the doctors and nurses who we train and pay better salaries, so that in the case of nurses, they're not all poached by Canada, the UK, and Australia, which is what's happening at the moment, a massive net drain of nurses out of Anglophone Africa, that we halt that by paying a living wage. Those things are all polyvalent. Those things will all bring wide benefits to the healthcare system. But you're absolutely right, it's a big challenge and it's an urgent one.
Please. I want to thank you for your comments. I'm Mike Cohen, the director of the Center of Infectious Disease on this campus. And one of the things that's transpired that I'm very curious about the Global Fund is the tension between treatment and prevention. Because before 2000, roughly, most of us were forced by total lack of therapeutic resources to work in resource-constrained countries only on prevention. There was no interest, actually. There was a barrier to treatment. Now the pendulum has swung so dramatically with resources for treatment that the fear is it washes away all of our prevention efforts. And if you could kind of comment on what you see as the future, especially vis-a-vis the Global Fund.
Yes. Well, I think that is an extremely important comment. And the enthusiasm for treatment, which is a good enthusiasm, must not diminish our enthusiasm for prevention. we at the moment, the Global Fund is investing far more in prevention than in treatment. But that balance may shift rapidly as the antiretroviral therapy programs scale up and as more of our money gets sucked into that. Our position will be that prevention remains essential. Prevention also needs to be greatly scaled up. Very, very few countries in Africa have mobilized successful prevention efforts. Uganda, Senegal, very few examples. And prevention in Africa remains a number one priority. In countries like India, prevention must be the number one priority because the task of India is to prevent becoming one gigantic Botswana, which would be a catastrophe beyond our imagination. I think an interesting thing that is emerging is the very strong symbiotic relationship between prevention and treatment. I think, and the bridge between them, of course, is voluntary testing and counseling. I think what we're going to see is the scale up of the access to treatment will fuel voluntary testing and counseling, because without the promise of treatment, why would I want to be tested? And that, in turn, will promote more vigorous and more successful efforts to prevention. And linked to that is the decline of stigmatization. I have anecdotally been very struck in those few places in Africa where substantial antiretroviral therapy is beginning to roll out, and you can begin to see the community impact of it. I think it is our biggest weapon against stigma. Not preaching from our various pulpits about the wickedness of stigma, but making this another disease where I get a test and I'm positive and I go to the clinic and I get pills and I get better and I have a life again and I go back to being a parent and a worker and I put on muscle mass and I'm dancing and singing again. This is a miracle that you've seen and that others in this audience have seen, and the community sees it, and it's massively destigmatizing. This is no longer a mysterious curse of God that comes on you because of your sinfulness or because of some other curse that you may have. This is normalizing a virus and a disease. And I think we're going to see this big impact on stigma from expanded treatment programs, and I think that's going to help prevention a lot because it makes it something that is easier to talk about. There was a lady. Yes, please.
Hi, Dr. Beacham. Thank you so much for coming to talk with us. I'm a graduate student in the microbiology and immunology department here at UNC. And, I can be louder if you need me to be. My question is in relation to one of the things that you mentioned in terms of availability of drugs. And I'm curious, do you have drug companies, do you have any liaisons with any drug companies that can possibly provide these drugs for the parts of Africa and Asia that desperately need the drugs to, I guess, scale back the pandemic?
We, if I heard the question correctly, we, the Global Fund, do not have any particular relations with any particular drug companies. We provide substantial money to recipients of that money in the developing countries for the purchase of drugs. And that money for the purchase of drugs is growing rapidly and will be a significant slice of all our investment within the next 2 or 3 years. It is for them to decide what they purchase and from where they purchase it. That's Malawi's decision, that's Nepal's decision, that's Honduras's decision, not our decision. We have 4 simple rules which we ask them to comply with, and we actually insist that they comply with. One is lowest price. The second is assured quality. The third is an international competitive tendering process. And the fourth is conformity with their national laws and regulations and with any international treaty that they may have entered into. Now, in practice, the application of those policies open the door very wide and lead to a competitive process in which the generic manufacturers in India and elsewhere, but mainly the Indian companies, compete with the major European and North American originators of the products. And that is a competition that the pharmaceutical industry has blessed and is comfortable with. That will lead, in some cases, to the purchase of generics, in some cases, to the purchase of branded drugs, depending on the outcome of that competitive process and the prices offered. And what we're seeing is that the global fund's finance is stimulating the demand side of the market enormously and changing the market. It's one of the reasons why prices are falling, now down under the best deals to about $140 a year, the deals brokered by the Clinton Foundation. And it's one of the reasons why supply is increasing. And that's very important, too. If everyone in the world today who needs to be on antiretroviral therapy suddenly started using antiretroviral pills, we would run out of antiretroviral drugs in about 5 minutes. The global supply is way below the theoretical demand. So manufacturing capacity has got to increase. And the supply has got to increase. And that won't occur unless the manufacturers have confidence in the demand, that the finance is there, that it's worth investing in the new factory or converting a factory to this purpose. And I think the Global Fund is bringing that confidence.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm getting the order wrong.
Thank you, Professor Feachem, for an excellent presentation. My name is Godfrey Sikipa. I work for RTI, and before joining RTI, a couple of months ago, I was working for UNAIDS in Geneva. You mentioned the growing global leadership to fight HIV/AIDS. And that's very encouraging because, as you correctly said, 5 years ago, or only 2 years ago, the issue of funding was problematic. However, can you give us your thoughts on leadership at a different level? I'm referring here to leadership at National AIDS Council, national level, district level, provincial level, the capacity and the leadership to coordinate the efforts of the various stakeholders. I'm talking about faith-based organizations, private sector, and civil society organizations. My fear is that at this moment, most of the countries, that capacity is lacking. And unless we actively work on building that capacity to lead at those levels, I suspect that 5-10 years down the line, we're going to look back and just say, what did all that money achieve?
Yeah. Well, it's nice to meet you here, Godfrey. Godfrey has just joined the Global Fund's technical review panel, which is a body of 25 men and women from all around the world who reject 62% of all proposals that they receive, and the most hated 25 men and women in the world. But they do a great job. They do a great job. They keep the bar high, which is very important for the credibility of the whole enterprise. And those who are not successful when they apply to the Global Fund come back next time round and have a very high success rate in their second attempt. So the system works. I completely agree. The need for not only health system infrastructure strengthening, but other kinds of support to enable subnational levels, district levels, to make full use of this enormous amount of new money that is beginning to flow for these purposes, to ensure that it's used in the right way for the right thing, to coordinate between the various flows and the various parties, and simple management, 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 management. Some of the countries in which we're investing may have a shortage of doctors and may have a shortage of nurses, but in some cases there's an even more acute shortage of people with really good credentials and expertise in program management, which is a very scarce skill in some parts of the world. I do think these things are challenging, and no easy answers. On a slightly provocative note, I would say that it would be a danger to, it would be, I think, not appropriate to overemphasize the need for coordination. Management of good programs, yes. Coordination, good to have, but not always essential, particularly when you're starting from scratch. And I sometimes go to meetings where I think coordination is being used as an excuse to do little and to go slowly. If I look at the rich world and some of the anti-HIV programs that I know best, I take Australia as an example, which I think is one of the very best anti-HIV AIDS programs in the developed world. And I ask myself, why is it successful? Is it successful because it's highly coordinated? I don't think so. I think it's successful because it lets 100 flowers bloom, or at least 50 flowers bloom. So I think sometimes we can overemphasize coordination when really what we want is action. And sometimes plurality of approaches are healthy when nobody really knows the right answer. Well, thank you, yes. And that's critical to the whole business model of the Global Fund. We are passive in the sense of having no hand and attempting to have no hand in who applies or the content of their application. Applications then come to our technical review panel. Up until now, 62% have been rejected, 38% accepted. That's not policy, it's how it's turned out to be. And we have so far had the resources to fully support all the successful proposals which have been recommended by the technical review panel. We then get into the different phase of providing the money for the successful programs. And performance is the critical element. We have a commitment, a very strong commitment, to performance-based financing. Something that people have been talking about for a decade or more. It's not well put into practice across the business of development finance, and it's much easier to say than to do. Our approach to this, which I think so far we have some cautious optimism about, but it's early days, is that after the first disbursement of funds, which is basically following the signing of the grant agreement, all subsequent disbursements are based on a disbursement request. And a disbursement request is a validated statement of performance. It doesn't say, this is what I've spent the money on. It's not input-based. It says, this is what I've done. These are some of the achievements. This is my performance. And those are related to the performance targets which were initially agreed when the grant agreement was signed and are contained in the grant agreement. Now, that provides a strong incentive to make up the numbers. And we're with Gavi, the Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization in this, they also provide a very strong incentive to make up the numbers. And so they, like us, require some independent validation, some eyes and ears on the ground to go and say, well, this is claimed as performance, but is it real? Can we see it? Is it happening? And that's exactly what we do. The statement of performance, which is sent to us to trigger the second check and the third check and the fourth check, is validated by our local agent. And we have run this huge international tender to appoint a local agent in every country where we have investments, in 121 countries, because we employ no one outside Geneva. we are the most centralized and the leanest of all development agencies. We run a multi-billion-dollar fund with 80 people. For your information, the World Bank employs 10,000 people, just to give you a little yardstick. Where was I? I like that comparison so much. I got distracted. Yes, and it's another interesting bit of the innovation because we did not know who would be successful. Local offices of the World Bank and the regional development banks were interested in playing the role. Local offices of the bilateral aid agencies were interested in playing the role. The competition was actually won by 6 organizations, and the majority of the contracts went to just 2, PricewaterhouseCoopers and KPMG. And they are our largest, by far, local fund agents. And I've had more hate mail about those decisions than any other decisions we've taken since the Global Fund was created. How can you employ these people? What do they know about development? They are money-grabbing, profiteering international accountancy firms. They won't provide a good service. They'll charge you too high fees, and they don't know anything about health anyway. All that has turned out to be wrong. We could talk about that for a couple of hours, but I must say the experience so far with using those companies to be our local eyes and ears is very positive, and it's another innovative feature about the Global Fund. But it is PricewaterhouseCoopers Dar es Salaam that gets in a Land Rover or a Toyota Land Cruiser and drives out to sites A, B, and C to see whether the claims about performance are true in practice and whether they can be validated. And if they are validated, then the second or the third check is in the mail. So we have a big commitment to performance-based funding. The other thing I'd briefly mention is that we receive 5-year proposals, 5-year programs, but we only initially commit to the first 2 years. And the threshold in moving from years 1-2 to years 3-4-5 is an evaluative threshold. And in the last part of calendar 2004, we come to the first renewals. The first batch of round one comes up for renewal starting August. And that's a new moment in the journey of the Global Fund. And we have a system now in place to make those evaluations. And I think that's going to be a tough hurdle. We're going to get some non-renewals. And that's all very important to make this mechanism work. The tough decisions can be as important as the positive decisions in establishing the right way to do this. That's a very challenging question. I share your implied premise, which is that we are quite capable of making this mistake again. It is not clear that we have internalized these lessons, and it's not clear, it's more than not clear, it's not the case that we have in place global structures that are fit for the purpose of identifying these enormous global threats early and tackling them strongly before it is too late. Optimistically, I feel, though, that we've made some cautious progress down that road. I think the recognition of HIV/AIDS and how slow and inadequate we've been is permeating through our systems. just in the arena of infectious diseases, which I think illustrates this probably better than most subjects, there is a vigilance and alertness in the world that we haven't seen before. The world's response to SARS a year ago, I think, was remarkably impressive. And 10 years earlier, it wouldn't have been like that, I don't believe. If there was a government of the world, the first thing they would do is create a CDC for the world. We don't have a government for the world, therefore we don't have a CDC for the world. And I think we urgently need our best surrogate for the CDC of a CDC for the world. I don't quite know what that would look like, but I think it's urgently needed. And it would focus, in my view, almost exclusively on infectious diseases.
Sorry, a brief question. I'm a medical student from another school down the road that I won't name. You mentioned the importance of money from the United States government in the fight against global AIDS, and I was wondering what your opinion was on the current administration not stipulating whether money that we give can be used to buy generic drugs, such as the ones you have on the podium there, and the implications that might have for how efficient that money will be in the Global Fund or any other mechanism.
It's an important question, and it's one that's under discussion between me and Ambassador Tobias and between the Global Fund and PEPFAR right at the moment. As I think you're aware, the PEPFAR team under Randall Tobias are very actively engaged in working out their policies on this subject. And they hosted a meeting in Botswana last week, which was entirely devoted to a part of this question, which was the use of fixed-dose combinations, which at the moment only come from the generics industries. Well, that's not completely true. There are several Glaxo people in the audience who will know that there are also Glaxo fixed-dose combinations. But if you look at the fixed-dose combinations most recommended as first-line treatment, they combine the intellectual property of three different companies. One American, one British, and one German. And therefore, they, at the moment, come only from the generics industry. So it's an important debate. It's an ongoing debate. We look forward to the conclusions that the PEPFAR team will arrive at. I don't know what they will be. It is certainly the case that if the drug procurement policies of the Global Fund, which, as I described earlier, are very liberal, and the drug procurement policies of PEPFAR are radically different, this will cause a major challenge in the 14 countries where we fully overlap. And we'll have to work very energetically to resolve that. It does not have any implication for the others of the 121 countries where we're operating. It's the 14 countries of the overlap where it really matters. We had meetings last week in Geneva with the Minister of Health of Mozambique about exactly this question. And of course, the Mozambique government is concerned about how they would handle such a situation. But it's ahead of us because we don't yet know what the PEPFAR policy is going to turn out to be. And of course, it may also change through time as more pharmacological and clinical evidence about fixed-dose combinations is available in the literature. Policies can change in the face of that evidence. Thanks. Thank you. Very good question. Excellent. Yes.